the rise for the national anthem?
जन गण मन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड़ उत्कल गंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उज्जल जगधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे।
Thank you everyone. I would now like to have the virtual lighting of the lamp, followed by which I would request Dean Programs Professor Abhay K. Oja to please give the welcome address to welcome Dr. Kiran Bedi. Thank you. I would request Professor Ojha to please give the welcome address.
Thank you. Namaskar. It's an honor for me to participate in this inaugural event of Vista 2020. This is the 20th edition of IMB's annual business summit. On behalf of the IMB community, particularly the student organizers, I welcome Honorable Lieutenant Governor Kiran Bedi, other dignitaries, faculty members, students, and other members of the audience at the inauguration of this festival, which will extend for the next few days. I was a young faculty member at IMB several years ago when Vista was sort of first launched. I would think it was pretty modest by today's standards, and I have seen it grow every year in terms of reputation, prestige, number of participants, stature of panelists and speakers who join. So I'm very proud that it has established itself as an event that everyone likes to mark on the calendar to attend. So I really like to thank the organizers for doing this. Sort of thanks to the pandemic, as Padmini and others already mentioned, this is the first time it is going to be entirely online. They would have had people contributing online earlier, but this is the first time that the program is entirely online. And around 8 months back when the pandemic hit, we didn't know what would happen, but I'm proud to say that IMB was first of the block trying to adapt to this new normal. And sort of we established benchmarks in terms of selection of technology platform, installation of classroom technologies, ways to conduct exam, and more recently, even developing protocols to bring students back to campus. Our sister IIMs and other institutions are kind of learning from us, and it's kind of pride for us to be the leader. Now I have to say our students also have pioneered to transfer this online, the Vista online. And I believe strongly that they will send new benchmarks that other student bodies will learn from and how to organize online events. Sort of, I know that the schedule has a galaxy of speakers and panelists who will speak to you for the next couple of days. But my immediate duty is to kind of welcome Lieutenant Governor Dr. Kiran Bedi to provide the inaugural address. I think Dr. Bedi needs no introduction, and you already saw a video of her transformation from a young child to who she is today. I kind of recall that around 12 years ago, I had the privilege of welcoming Dr. Bedi to this campus in the IMB auditorium. And of course, as you would expect, the auditorium was full. It was overflowing. Today, I have the pleasure and opportunity to welcome her to this new format. And I believe that the audience will be bigger than what she saw the last time, because this program is online. And I believe people across the world would have logged into it, and you have an opportunity to address a larger group of people. So thank you. Dr. Bedi will speak on our experiments with governance, Pondicherry, a case study. I kind of hand over to Dr. Bedi for her address. And Madam, welcome once again. Thank you.
Let me begin by saying thank you so much for inviting me to such a prestigious event. The IMMs are the ultimate destinations for many, many thousands of young men and women and bright people who don't go to the All India Civil Services. It's a choice between the IMMs and the UPSC. Both are equally attractive and both are equally promising. So I want to thank you, Anmol Gupta, for who's the secretary of ISTA, and our dean, Ms. Dr. Ahuja, who fondly remembers 12 years ago. I wish we could have seen the pictures, what we looked like, both of us, you 12 years ago and I 12 years ago, and say, this is the way it was. Anyway, it's a pleasure.
I do have those pictures and I treasure them.
There you are. You know, this invite has actually enabled me to put things together for you. Because I know you are all case study based. I have to produce evidence. And I cannot match you in theory. But I am not easily matchable in experience. So I cannot beat you on theory, but I can tell you, you won't beat me in experience in administration when it comes to city management. So I thought I will build on my strength. But the fact is that whatever we've done as experiments, and I'm using the word not good governance, I'm using the word true governance. Because the 4.5 years I've been here, the whole concept has been on truth, truthful governance. Even now, just before I connected with you, I've just taken a very strong stand in recent on a police recruitment, which is going a little wrong direction. It was going wrong direction. It was trying to avoid technology in recruitment, was bringing in more human element. I got to know it only 2 days ago as the Lieutenant Governor that the recruitment was going wrong. 2 days ago. And I didn't ask for reports. As Lieutenant Governor, I only asked for the file because there was no time, because they had called for the physical test recruitment this next week, Tuesday, Wednesday. That means these youngsters, men would and women, would have all flocked to Puducherry in COVID times. So where was the time for a written report? I'm giving you an immediate example of true governance, which I finished 10 minutes ago, just 10 minutes ago. In fact, I was struggling with it before I was. So here it is. And we called for the file because I am entitled under the law to call for files. As Lieutenant Governor, that's the difference between being a governor and a Lieutenant Governor of a unit. Abided by that, sent me the file. And the file spoke for itself that the complaint which I got was true. There was a violation of the notification which was issued in 2018 on the manner in which the recruitment had to be done. And it was technology based, where you would have the chip under the toe to run and you would know the timing. Here method was to take away the technology and do it by like that, the whistles. So imagine, and the complaints were abound now that now it will be, where all do we complain, etc., etc. So I called for the file. Moment I saw the file, the complaint was true. I cancelled the recruitment. I've just cancelled it, which meant 16,000 people getting SMS now saying don't come. So this is what I'm talking about as an example of immediate true governance. So the word is true governance, because I don't think we meet the standards of good governance as laid down by the United Nations, because good governance includes the rule of law. And our rule of law doesn't meet those standards at all. For various reasons, that's another subject for another time. So I have a wonderful presentation for you. I'd like to run it immediately. And it's a case study by itself. I'll pause where I feel like, or I may not disturb you. Have a look at it, form your own view, and then we'll get to Q&A immediately, because then you'll have seen actually. Go ahead. Let's quickly run the presentation. And it's all visual, developed over the last 4 years by my documentation cell, which we've been carefully going. It begins with my beginning of the service here. Can we go? Or we aren't ready. Be a speaking presentation by itself, seeing and speaking. This is my arrival at the Lieutenant Governor's office. This is the way the Lieutenant Governor's office lives. This goes back to 2016. This is the mantra I gave them. This is my first meeting with public officials. I did a SWOT analysis on day one with them. And I knew their strengths, weaknesses, and opportunities. Based on that, I've dovetailed my purpose. I've built 5 pillars of invite, involve, resolve, and resolve. Here is the first evidence of invite. Open the doors for Raj Nivas. Inviting the people to come. We opened the Raj Nivas to people. I'm showing you certain things which you may otherwise never get to see how such institutions function. But this is all coming under invite. It's all about invite. So the first thing was to integrate people by invitation to Raj Nivas by several occasions, several events. You see all sections of society. Raj Nivas launches cinema halls. Open air theatres. These are Swachhta women who clean the city. The first section is invite. Also had the dignitaries, from Swachhta women, the diplomats, the Honorable President of India. They were our special invitees and visitors. This is Darbar Hall of Raj Nivas. This is the team Raj Nivas. The second is involve. From invite to involve. Now we got involved. Involving with people. Prison reforms, cleaning the beaches, Ramadan with volunteers, dengue prevention, cleaning by leading, NCC cadets, so it's involved. Green working with NGOs, the corporates, involving them. I'm giving you true governance. They were our CSR partners. Third, resolve. From invitation, from involvement, to now resolving. What you're seeing is an open house for grievances, where anybody and everybody comes free without, with just a token, Monday to Wednesday. Before COVID came, this was the open house. Now it's all virtual. Earlier it was physical. Every petition is documented, analyzed, attended. These are the things which our morning open houses took us to, problems which were coming, to resolve them. And we did weekend rounds by biking. I'm missing it during COVID times now. We did every weekend was a morning round where we brought in the people. And we went to the dirty places, the dirty ponds, the lakes, which needed attention. And this led to surprise inspections. The biking was not an exercise. It was going to locations. Wherever the open house gave us a complaint. So these were almost like surprise inspections. But along with it was involving people. Resolution, resolving, police stations, inspections, healthcare, anything which came through. Now we are on solve. It came to solutions. This is a landmark in Puducherry where medical colleges seats. The fees is capped. Went up right up to the Supreme Court, we took on the mafia. So it was now solving. These were the mafia case. We went into CBI investigations. So this is solving issues, not leaving them. We found pro bono. Medical colleges have been fined by the fighters. So it was solving issues. This is what we did in Puducherry. Where we brought the CSRs to desilt our canals, solving problems. We had no money. There was no money here. But we found the CSRs to solve problems and improving the table of Puducherry by many, many feet, many meters. This is a donor's gallery we published and we rewarded them. So it resolves medical seat scam or mission water or even direct transfer. Direct transfer of money. We did not let anything go. This is the pet project of our Honorable Prime Minister. We made sure there's no transmission loss, even though it annoyed my Honorable Chief Minister. Now we evolve. We have evolved. We make our disposal public. What have we done during the week was public. We announce the list. Everybody knows what happened on the file. So you needed the RTI, we've done itself. And we do a weekly message and our publications. These are all on our websites. So it is about all our documentation. I'm leaving enough documentation behind, a lot of institutional memory for this to continue. So in case you have a question to ask what will happen after you go, well, for others to continue, there's enough documentation left behind. And this is on COVID management, not giving up, but continue to evolve and working now through virtual. IRISE. The concept is IRISE. IIRSE, I've already shared with you, it's IRISE. Wish to thank you for sparing your time to see through problems by Team Raj Dibas, which is also listening to this presentation. And present here is Asha Gupta, Isha Arora, Mani, Vijay, all who've done last 4 years of work. Surinder, all of them are involved into behind this. So here is this visualization showing you visually how we've done true governance so joyfully, so blessed, so privileged that one got an opportunity to serve Puducherry like this. So I don't have to explain. Now, when I look at leadership concepts and leadership books, I find something or the other fitting in. Now I leave it to you. You, the brightest students, to see whatever we did, under which concept does it fit in? Which theory does it fit in? Because as I read the Harvard Business Reviews and the books on leadership and articles, I find something or the other which we had done in Puducherry fitting into something like that. Only thing is they give it a name, I've given my name. Okay, friends, all yours. Questions, all your questions, I'm happy to answer. Now that you've seen, you don't need to ask me, you may not ask me what I did. You may ask me why I did. But what I did, I've already shown to you. I don't see you smiling. I don't see your faces smiling. Yeah, that's better now. Please smile. It's so joyful being together. These are rare opportunities of life where once in a lifetime when we meet. Even if you're meeting virtually today, it's great. It's such an almighty's grace that technology has enabled us to at least do an eye contact and see you smiling. All right, friends. I go back to your moderator, your dean, Mr. Ahuja. Go ahead, all yours. I've done my job.
Yeah, actually, Sashi will ask the question.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Anmol, can you please start with the questions?
Yes. Ma'am, we thanks a lot for this inspiring and insightful question, ma'am. Inspiring and insightful presentation, ma'am. The first question that we have from the audience is, in a country where it might seem that women empowerment is only a political agenda, what were the problems you had to face to come to the position you are in? And how did it feel to be the first female IPS officer of the country?
Look, I was a woman gifted with opportunities. And I think the best opportunity I had was visionary parents who put me to the best school. They sent me to the best university. They invested the best into. I was a woman gifted with opportunities with visionary parents. And I was also gifted with good health. So if I wouldn't do this, then who else will do? That means I was myself either a blockade into myself or a progressor. I chose to be the latter. So if I'd held myself back, I alone was responsible for it. But I didn't. I have continued to grow and evolve. So I would say, you ask me what was the handicap? I said, none. I alone would have been my own handicap. So I would say any woman who's has what I had, visionary parents, best of schooling, doesn't matter if I belong to a small town. It didn't matter that I didn't belong to a metropolitan city. I belong to a town called Amritsar. It didn't have the best of the tennis coaching schemes. Bombay had, Chennai had, Calcutta had, South clubs. I didn't have, but I had the tennis wall. I had the wall. What I'm saying is, it didn't matter whether I belong to a, not a metropolitan. So, which means that I would say a woman gifted the manner in which I was. She is her own destination. It's up to her how far she wants to go. And for me, sky is the limit.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question that we have from the audience is, as you have been a warrior against corruption and given your rich experience, do you think it is a good idea to link all land records with Aadhaar cards to battle the black money menace? And election cards with Aadhaar cards as a first step to clean a voting system, the foremost front of democracy.
Can you make the question a little shorter to the point? What is it you're sorry?
We want to ask, the audience wants to ask if it is a good idea to link land records and election cards with the Aadhaar card as a first step to cleaning our voting system and getting rid of the black money menace.
100%. There's no doubt about it.
Right. The next question that we have is, what is the driving force that helps you accomplish such achievements?
Is my own sense of achievement. It's my own realization. It's my own potential. It's owing my own responsibility. I owe it to myself to continue to grow every day. I owe it to myself to read every day. I owe it to myself to stay physically fit every day. I owe it to myself to give meet the higher purpose of my job every day. I don't need to be told. I don't need to be told at all what is my own responsibility. So I tell myself. I don't even tell myself. My inside drives me. I don't need a reminder.
The next question is, what advice would you like to give management graduates when they join the corporate soon?
What advice should I give to?
Management graduates, MBA students who are going to join corporate soon.
Find out the purpose of what you're doing. What's your purpose? Is your purpose only money making or giving best for the money you will make from? That's your purpose. Are you there for profit? Or profiteering? Or are you for the people whom you're going to be employed for? Are you for the product or you, persons behind the product, the consumer? Are you a leader or are you a follower? I think you owe it to yourself. And coming to these institutions like these, I think you first owe it the money you will earn. But money for what? Is it to money for livelihood or life or building lives and contributing to the prosperity of the country? I would say latter.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question that we have is, how do you think we can improve our education system? Because most students feel that our education system focuses on marks more than knowledge and skills.
That's where it's gone wrong. It's not building lives. It's not building persons. It's not making them conscientious and with a loud conscience. It's neither conscientiousness nor with a conscience. It's making only, I think, only IQs, not EQs, and nowhere the SQs. I think ours is more into intelligence quotient and grading and marks, not about greater human beings. And then also spiritual human beings. And spiritual human being is not dogmatic. It's not ritualistic. It's being humane and human.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question that we have from the audience is, given that Puducherry is fragmented across geographies, what are the challenges that you face because of this?
Well, there is a challenge of distance and commuting. It is a challenge because the amount of time which Puducherry sees me directly here, Mahe, Yanam and Karikal don't. That's a fact. And so it's a question of choices, priority. So there is a distance lost. But because of our WhatsApp groups, because of our technology, because of our constant communication, we have narrowed the gap. And our grievance redressal system, where everybody is accessible to everybody, we've narrowed it. They're not cut off. In fact, believe me, the opening statement where I talked about the recruitment, the complaint came from Yanam, which is far away, which is next to, which is on the border of Andhra Pradesh. They came and saying, these are the drawbacks which are going to be happening. Already an exploitation has started. It came from Yanam, which is far away. So that basically means they know the Lieutenant Governor's office is 100% 24/7 connected. And by the way, my mobile phone is 100% number available for anybody in Yanam, Mahe, or Karikal. So we are only one WhatsApp message enough to talk, to find, to FaceTime, to do virtual, and immediately get going. And the best part is we name and shame. We have a group called Prosperous Puducherry. In that Prosperous Puducherry, if there's a complaint comes, we put it there. And in Prosperous Puducherry, 300 officers of all regions are a part of it. Everybody hears to see what's the complaint. And by and large, I've never seen anybody abusing this space. The complaint is grievances, right? And it gets attended. And it also replied what happened between, because everybody knows what's complained, where does it come from, who is it against. There's nothing, nothing shyness about it.
Right. Thank you, ma'am. And the next question that we have is a broad question, which says, what are the current major issues in India, according to you? If you could just list two or three most important issues for India that you feel is most relevant in today's time.
I think it's time for Atmanirbhar. I 100% agree. It is time to now go in for our own change. I think we need to have our own marketing change. We need to reduce our dependence on other countries, particularly the neighbors. We must go in for more and more of self-reliance as soon as possible. And I've seen this happen in COVID. From literally no laboratory to do these COVID tests, we got thousands today. From no PPE equipment being manufactured, we got abundance today. The manner in which the pharmaceutical is picked up. And not only is it supplying to us, it's now contributing to the rest of the world. I think you owe it to the country, every aspect of when you are in a product or a company, what is it that can be substituted by Atmanirbhar? Second is financial integrity. I think the day we as a country become financially integrated, don't hide your GSTs, don't run parallel accounts, we will contribute to the exchequer much more. Our project management must not overrun so that we don't have to spend more and more crores after. If we get into financial integrity and going to an eye for Atmanirbhar and going for better manufacturing here and more of initiatives and improve our work culture, I think India will be very rich in another 2-3 years. I see a great scope.
Right. Thank you, ma'am. And the next question that we have from the student community is that because of the COVID situation over the past few months, we feel slightly depressed due to not being able to have direct human contact with our peers, family, etc. What would be your suggestion as the best step for the youngsters to take now?
The fault is yours. You do not know how to do mind management. That's your problem. That's exactly what I said. You've done only IQ. You've not done any EQ and SQ. Had you done your EQ and SQ, you wouldn't have had this question at all. On the contrary, you would have said, this has been a bonanza from working from home. I've had time to read more, create more, learn more, upskill more, and also network more. What's your problem?
Right. Right, ma'am, you're very right. Ma'am, the next question that we have from the audience is, how do you tackle any hindrances or oppositions from the people who work with you under your administration?
How do I tackle what?
Any hindrances?
I just remove them. I then put them aside. I walk over them.
Right.
And suddenly when they get left behind, they join me back. I don't wait for them to perform. I'll give you an example. When I started the morning rounds every weekend, do you know who were the biggest obstacles? The honorable elected representatives of Puducherry, called the MLAs. I wanted to take them along, that if I'm going to see a dirty pond or a bridge or something, a road or a dirty situation, come along, let's go together. Initially, they said they'll come along. I would wait a few minutes. My ADC would call them saying, Madam is waiting. Lieutenant Governor is waiting. It's not Kiran Bedi waiting. Lieutenant Governor is waiting. They said, oh, aaj hum Madras chale gaye, aur udhar chale gaye. So I saw the first 2 weeks, they tested me whether I would wait for them and not go on the round to look at the issue to solve and resolve. When after 2 weeks I found, then the rule was inform them, record it as an SMS. Say it's not that we didn't inform you, but go on regardless. Do you know what happened? They got left behind.
That's good. On the next question that we have, and this is the last question in interest of time, is how scalable is the Puducherry model? What would be your suggestions for bigger states like Maharashtra and Uttar Pradesh? Will the same model be applicable?
Look, every area has its own culture, has its own mindset, has its own SWOT. has its own strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. As long as we understand the SWOT of that area, the people, you see, it's the people, the priorities and the purpose. I think all the three P's are very important. The kind of people you have, the kind of priorities that they have, right? What kind of purpose they have. If we can set that right on a SWOT, it's scalable. After all, what is scalable? What are you talking about scalable? It's truth and governance. Is truth ever in doubt? Is truth not replicable anywhere? Why not? Is peace not replicable? It just has to assume different kind, take into stride different challenges. So true governance is replicable anywhere. True governance needs personal integrity. So wherever the leadership and the managers are wanting this kind of, are beginning with themselves, they lead the way. No difference between video and audio. Video and audio must match. Wherever the video and the audio is willing to match, I think it's scalable. But if the video is something else and the audio is something else, then it isn't. What has happened in Puducherry model from the lieutenant governor's office is there is no difference between the audio and the video. That's it. And then the purpose is very much known that Raj Nivas is for people. It's for the prosperity of people. That's why one of the first mission statements when I came here was given to Puducherry was prosperous Puducherry. And in prosperous Puducherry, it is means all encompassing. Every decision which is judicious, everything which can be saved is saved, but everywhere which has to be spent is spent. And everybody involved. And it's a teamwork, it's not an individual. That's why I mentioned to you that even this presentation is a product of a very strong teamwork built over the years. So it's replicable, provided the ingredients and the intention is this. If the intention is doubtful, then I'm sorry, it is not. Because it cannot be half-baked. Either you have it or you don't have it. You are otherwise, you are misleading and misguiding. And sometimes you will get exposed. There's nothing hidden in hidden agendas here. Anybody, I wish this was not COVID time. I would have invited many of you to become interns here with me and work here. In fact, last summer we had interns and we welcomed interns and we groomed lots of interns. I wish it wasn't COVID time. I would have said Raj Nivas invites you to be interns with us when things are okay and things are better next year. And if I'm still around, it's an open invitation for you to join us.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, ma'am. Thank you for your time and your inspiring words. I would also like to thank Professor Oja and Professor Srinivasan for their time. As a token of our appreciation, a contribution has been made in your name to SayTrees, an organization that works on tree plantation in India. Agroforestry saplings have been planted in your name and has made a difference to the life of a farmer in Karnataka. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Wish you all very well and a happy Diwali as it comes. Thank you. Keep smiling. Keep smiling every time you do virtuals. Please smile at the guest speakers. It inspires the guest speakers. When I see you smiling, it's made me smile more. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.